Ladies and gentlemen,
a warm welcome to the Faculty of Economics and Business. Someone left her earrings here. Perhaps it's a silent hint for me. Welcome to staff and students from the University of Groningen. Also, welcome to the members of the Blackboard Academic Leadership Tour, and also a warm welcome to participants who are joining us on the live stream, participants in Amsterdam and everywhere else in the world. This meeting is hosted by the Department of Education, Innovation and Support, and I would like to thank them for organizing this meeting. Today is Thanksgiving Day. It's a national holiday celebrated in the United States, the home country of our speaker. It's a day of giving thanks for the harvest of last year. Today is also the closing day of the Tour de Mazur in the Netherlands. During the tour this week, Professor Eric Mazur visited several universities in the Netherlands, where he motivated staff and students, and he led several workshops and presented keynotes and plenary talks. And today, I think we can start harvesting ideas and proposals that are the result of this tour. Innovation in science, innovation in education, and innovation in educational science are key points in the work of Professor Eric Mazur. Eric is a physics professor at Harvard University, where he arrived in 1982. But important for us, and perhaps a little bit chauvinistic, he was born in the Netherlands and obtained his PhD from Leiden University. In science, and especially in optical physics, Eric is internationally recognized as an author of more than 300 scientific publications, and he is a vice president of the Optical Society of America. As a role model for students, he combines science with entrepreneurship, as he is a founder of several companies and plays an active role in industry. In education, again, Eric is internationally recognized as an expert. In the 1990s, he developed the instrument of peer instruction, an innovative and interactive teaching method. Peer instruction has now been recognized worldwide as a driver for improvement in learning outcomes. And more recently, Eric initiated and advocated the development of the concept of the flipped classroom. Last year, Professor Mazur was awarded the prestigious Minerva Prize for decades of innovation in the classroom. We, at the University of Groningen, first met Eric when we started to develop the didactic concepts of learning communities in the flipped classroom. We developed those concepts because we strive to further develop an academic and social environment in which students are actively involved in their own education process and in which learning and personal talent development take center stage. Learning communities are highly valued as an environment in which staff and students exchange, generate and integrate knowledge in an innovative, close-knit, international academic classroom. A community in which excellent teaching and motivated learning is the standard. At the University of Groningen, our goal is to provide first-class teaching that is, of course, based on our research strengths, give students the opportunity to study and work at the forefront of knowledge, impart to students the necessary skills, attitudes, and knowledge that they will need to compete successfully in the international labor market. Our educational programs on learning communities, international classroom, and flipping the classroom are a very important step towards achieving those goals. I would like to draw your attention to some aspects of the program. Please be aware that there is a live stream with this keynote. Questions, if you have any questions, during the talk, you can ask your questions using the hashtag Tour de Mazur on Twitter. Our moderator will use this channel in collaboration with Eric. Afterwards, there's also time for questions. The audience here and at the live stream would like to follow the discussion. Therefore, please wait till you have a microphone. And please mention if you're a teacher or a student, and also mention your faculty or institute. We will, of course, follow up on the activities today. The slides will be available as well as the recordings. Everyone who has registered will receive a mail with a website, a link to the website for this information. At our Day of Education in January in 2016, there will be a workshop dedicated to the Tour de Mazur and its results. Finally, you're invited to join us at the closing event at the Duisenberg Plaza nearby, where there will be drinks and snacks. But for now, I think we should focus on today. Why is it that stellar students sometimes fail in the workplace while dropouts succeed? One reason is that most, if not all, current assessment practices are inauthentic. Just as the lecture focuses on the delivery of information to students, so does assessment often focus on having students repeat the same information back to the instructor. Consequently, assessment fails to focus on the skills that are relevant in the 21st century. Assessment is what we could call part of the hidden curriculum, as it is an important driver of students' study habits. Unless we rethink our approach to assessment, it will be very difficult to produce a meaningful change in education. So I would like to give a warm welcome to Professor Mazur and ask him to start his keynote speech. Thank you.
Thank you very much. A few years ago, I was boarding a flight in New York to fly to Buenos Aires, long flight. And as I settled into my seat, I found myself sitting next to a young woman who was panicked about flying. So she wanted to have somebody to talk to. And I was the neighbor sitting next to her. And she told me she had just obtained her degree from the University of Chicago. And she was now working for a cloud-based education company. Now, I just founded my own cloud-based education company. I thought I better find out what she's doing. Turns out, her company was producing flashcards. You know, these cards that have questions on one side and answers on the other for smartphones. Well, those of you who followed my career know that I don't place much value on the memorization of information. So I almost rolled my eyes, but I managed to remain polite. Now, earlier that week, I had attended a talk at Harvard by an educational psychologist by the name of Rudy Rodinger. He is on the faculty at Washington University. He's a very well-known educational psychologist who studies memory, and in particular, he studies retention of information from studying with flashcards. And in research that was widely publicized in the popular press and in journals in about 2010, so 5 years ago, he showed that if you study with flashcards, you remember quite well for a few days. So if you test students 2 days later, they'll remember about 80-85%. But if you wait a week, you find that they remember only 35%. And if you wait another week, you cannot even measure it. I thought she should know that. So I grabbed my iPad, I looked up the paper by Ready Rating, which I downloaded on my iPad, and I handed her my iPad. She looked at it for no more than 10 seconds and then handed me back my iPad. And she looked me right in the eyes and she said, "But we only guarantee that they will pass the test." I had never thought about it that way. But it brought back all kinds of memories. My daughter, my oldest daughter, was an undergraduate student at Harvard, which was really nice because she could travel with me home during the weekends, and then on Monday morning, we'd drive back to campus. And I remember one Monday morning, I was sitting in the driver's seat, she was sitting to my right in the passenger seat, and I look over my shoulder, she's using flashcards. "Natalie, what are you doing using flashcards?" You know, we'd spoken often about, as you might imagine, with a father who's interested in education, about, best approaches to learning, and the word flashcard had not appeared in the vocabulary. So she looks up at me and says, Dad, I have to know all these amino acids. I said, amino acids? I have an app for that. Seriously, you know, I do work in biophotonics, so occasionally I need to know the amino acids, but I'm sorry, I don't use them often enough to remember them, so whenever I need them, I look them up, and if I don't need them, I forget it again. She looks at me and she says, Dad, I'm not allowed to use the iPhone during the exam. Which made me realize that even students with the best of intentions are forced to use study habits that are really not conducive to learning. Now, those of you who have followed my career know that I've spent many years, 25 years, in bashing the lecture as an outmoded approach to disseminating information. That experience made me realize that assessment too focuses on the regurgitation of often memorized information or perhaps the application of rote procedures. And therefore, instead of developing 21st century skills, our assessment practices are really focused on ranking and classifying students. And I will argue that we actually do a very poor job in our ranking and classification of students. So here's what I would like to do with you. I first like to talk a little bit about the purpose of assessment. Why are we doing assessment? What is the purpose of assessment? And we'll do that a little bit interactively. Then I'll tell you about what I think are some major problems that we have with our current assessment practices. And because I don't want to leave you here on a negative note, we'll end this lecture by talking about some potential improvements in our assessment practices. So let's start with that first part, purpose of assessment. I want you to get together with three or four people around you. If you don't know your neighbor, you may want to briefly introduce yourself to your neighbor. And assign a note taker. And I, as a little group of three or four people, I want you to write down as many purpose of assessment as you can think of. Okay, you have a few minutes, so you got to work hard. Go ahead. Ik zal de mensen vragen om te rapporteren. Ik zal de mensen vragen om te rapporteren, maar het gaat waarschijnlijk te snel aan de microfoon. Maar ik zal altijd herhalen wat ze zeggen. Okay. Het gaat gewoon te snel. Okay. Let's see. How many of you have more than five reasons for assessment? Let me see a show of hands. Good. People on this part have been working harder than in the back. That's generally true in a classroom, you know? The students in the front work harder than the ones in the back. I'll come to the back later on. Okay, so let's hear a few. And unfortunately, I don't know how to make people in the live stream participate. Maybe they can tweet it, and I can see it here on my screen. So you can tweet it, but let's first give the audience here an opportunity. So I want somebody to read off one item from their list. Don't rattle off the entire list. One item from your list. Who wants to start? Yes. And I'll repeat it. Oh, okay.
To show competence.
To show competence. Okay, very good. Anybody else? Who's next? Say it loudly, I'll repeat it. In order to judge the fulfillment of the learning outcomes. Okay? Next one, here.
To check whether they actually
learned something. I would say that's pretty much the same thing, okay?
Students to learn, to motivate them.
To motivate students to learn. Yes?
I think more or
less the
same. To see where you can improve.
To see where you can improve. When you say you, do you mean the instructor or the students?
Well,
maybe both. Very good. I saw a hand up here in the front. No? Nope. Yes?
Basically very simple, because we have to give grades.
Because we have to give grades. Why in the world do we have to give grades? The good thing is that there are some administrators sitting here in the front row, so we can talk with them at the break. Yes? We need the grades to standardize education. Okay, very good.
We use them as closure for an assignment or a course.
As closure for an assignment or a course, yeah. By the way, when I say yes, I don't mean approval or anything.
To test understanding.
To test understanding. I saw another hand up here. You're the same. Okay, one or two more. To select students.
As a reward for students' efforts.
As a reward for students' efforts. Let me see if the live stream, if anybody has something that I should say here. No, I don't see anything here. Ranking and classifying, I see here. Okay, so I don't see anything. As, you know, I can't really read very quickly, but yes, you want to say something.
Forcing them to study.
It's so conducive to learning, isn't that? Are there some students in the room here? I would love to hear from students. Okay, you can get back at all the instructors who have said something now. So yes, what does assessment mean for you?
Forcing
you to study. In other words, you would. There was not a hair on your head that who would think of studying.
Yeah, of course.
Oh, okay. It is something to have a stick and a carrot. Yes.
To hold educators accountable.
Oh, so educators here in the room. So you know now. Okay, another student, please. To prove you're valuable. Very interesting. I hadn't heard that one before. There's one over there. Or Ina, do you want to say something?
They have something from Amsterdam. They say to evaluate the learning goals.
To evaluate the learning goals. Very good. What about you?
Yeah, I think it's more to predict future success.
To predict future success. You said actually two things there. One was to predict future, and I would like to disentangle them. To predict future success. And the other is to tell whether or not somebody can progress to the next level, master's or, yeah, we'll talk about that in just a second. Here's my list, and I think, you know, we covered most of those things. To rate and rank the students. She is better than he is, he's better than she is, and so on, right? To end up with a pecking order. Secondly, we sort of heard that from the students, to rate the professor and the course. In some sort of an absolute sense,
and in the eyes of colleagues, the department, and so on. To motivate the students to keep up with work, we heard that in a number of different variants. To provide feedback on the learning to the students, this is how I can improve my performance. I do this well, but I should really look at this. To provide feedback to the instructors. Oh my God, I did a lousy job teaching these students. Or, you know, I really did a good job. To provide instructional accountability. We heard that actually in a couple of different variants. And to improve the teaching and the learning. It's something that, you know, tells us what we're doing right and what we're not doing right. It's quite a list, huh? How can you combine all of these things in one activity? And you know what? You all forgot a really important reason for the assessment. I'm going to show you a picture very briefly to jog your memory. Here we go. So that we instructors can fly to conferences and keep our students busy back home. You know, I'm sure that a number of instructors have actually used that technique to free themselves from other activities. Anyway, we see right off the bat here that we have a problem, right? How can you do so much with one type of activity, right? But actually, the problems are much deeper than that. I already mentioned that most of our assessment is really not that authentic because it tests the regurgitation of memorized facts or the reproduction of a rote procedure that the students have seen before. But I would claim that even if you see exams that pretend to test problem solving. I mean, if you go to any professor in the science department, whether it's in this university or my university, and you ask them, what are you really testing? They say, well, I'm testing my students' problem solving performance. I would argue it doesn't really do that. It tests inauthentic problem solving. What do I mean by that? Let's think about a moment. What is a real problem? If you have a problem, and we all face problems in our lives, right? We usually know what the desired outcome is. You have a job interview in San Francisco. You go to Amsterdam Airport Schiphol to catch the last flight to San Francisco. There's fog at Schiphol, the flights have been canceled. You got a problem. You have to be at an interview the next day and there's no flight. The outcome, the desired outcome is known. The big question, the big problem you have to solve is how to get there in the remaining time. Any type of problem, whether it's business or engineering or science, actually fits that pattern. You know where you want to go. It's not the outcome that is the problem. The problem is how to get to that problem, finding a solution. Now, for the scientists among you and the engineers, let's think about the type of problems we give our students on an exam or on homework or whatever. We have a problem, and the problem essentially requires the students to apply a known procedure to find an unknown answer, and you're evaluated on the answer. Let me give an example from my own field, and I'll just sketch it out. I won't give you any details. A car goes along a road, blah, 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 and so on, more information, and then at the end, it hits the tree, and just the last sentence of the problem says, what is the velocity of the car just before it hits the tree? Student sits there at the table, sees what is the velocity. What are the equations I know that permit me to calculate velocity? Oh, there's that equation. I can't use that equation because I don't know all the parameters out. There's this equation. Maybe I can use that. And there's this other equation. No, I can't use that. Let me use that equation. Plug the numbers in, turn the crank. Out comes the number, 4.2 meters per second. And then if that's the right answer, you earn your points. Do you see the difference between the authentic problem at the top, the type of problems our students will face in their lives, in their careers, and the one at the bottom? Let's put this in light of Bloom's taxonomy. Benjamin Bloom was an educational psychologist in the 50s in the US who came up with this taxonomy, this ordering of thinking skills from lower order thinking skills at the bottom to higher order thinking skills at the top. All the way at the bottom is remembering facts. in what year did the French Revolution start? Or, you know, what happens when you release a ball a certain height above the ground? It drops. And so on. And then the next level is understanding, know how facts are interrelated. The next level is applying, taking what you've learned in one context and apply that to a new context that you've not seen before. The next level is analyzing, determining what knowledge you need in order to solve a particular problem. Then comes evaluating, assessing whether or not any solution or any answer you get to a problem makes sense. And all the way at the top is the elusive goal of any education, creativity, innovation. I would argue that in most education, including higher education at top schools like this one or my own, we do not even get to level three, applying. We're stuck at the bottom. You know, not that long ago, I can't resist telling you this little anecdote. I was at a university south of Boston in Connecticut, a really good university, but I won't name any names, just that it was in Connecticut. And I was giving a talk about education in the physics department, and after my talk, one of the instructors came to me and said, "That's something really strange happened in my classroom this year." He had been teaching physics to engineering students, and he wanted to make physics relevant to these engineering students. So he decided to take physics and put it into a real-world context. And the context that he chose was baseball. I mean, there's a lot of physics in baseball, right? Trajectories of balls, collisions between balls and bats, runners running. So in class, he would use examples from baseball. On the homework, he would put baseball problems. On the midterm examination, he put baseball problems. At the end of the semester, he was preparing the final exam, and he realized he had run out of baseball problems. So he put some football problems on the exam. "Professor," complained the students, "we have never done any football problems." You're laughing about it. You know, we should really be crying. Because you have to admit, if you can't take what you've learned and apply it to a new context, you have not really learned. Let me try to illustrate this slightly differently. I'm going to take a problem which I think is really an authentic problem and then slowly deconstruct that problem and turn it into a standard textbook problem. And then we're going to see what happens to Bloom's taxonomy, to the skills that are required to solve this problem. Let me first tell you briefly about Enrico Fermi. Enrico Fermi was an Italian physicist who participated in the Manhattan Project. And after the war, he became a professor at the University of Chicago. And he became known for starting his classes at the University of Chicago, his physics classes, by asking estimation problems. Those type of problems are now called Fermi problems. The idea was to teach people qualitative thinking skills. So he would walk into the classroom, he would look at his students and would say, "How many piano tuners are there in Chicago?" Physics course, okay? Your first reaction might be, "How am I supposed to know this?" Or you might just guess, 100, 1,000, I don't know. But if you just guess, you don't have much confidence in your guess. The other approach would be to reason through it. Let's see, there are about 10 million people in Chicago, so, you know, if we divide this by four, about 2 million families. Let's say that one in 10 families, maybe one in 20, whatever, has a piano. So that means there are somewhere between 100,000 and 200,000 pianos. I'll round it down, 100,000 pianos. How many pianos can a piano tuner tune in a week or in a year? Anyway, you get the gist, right? So basically by breaking down the problem into little bits and estimating quantities, you end up with a number, and if we were to do this exercise, most of us would end up in the 25 range. And if you look actually online how many piano tuners there are in Chicago, it's 25, it's pretty good. Now, I'm not Enrico Fermi, but these type of questions often come up spontaneously in my mind, weird physicist that I am. A number of years ago, 10, 15 years, I don't exactly remember, I was painting our dining room and on a Saturday morning, and I ran out of paint. I had to hop into the car, drive to Harvard Square to go to the hardware store. And on a Saturday morning, it's hard to find a parking spot in Cambridge, but there's this hotel, right? In Harvard Square, it keeps changing its name. I think right now it's Harvard Square Hotel. It was used to be Harvard Square Motel, Harvard Lodge, whatever. Now it's the Harvard Square Motel. The hotel sits on stilts, elevated from street level. And underneath the first floor of the hotel is a parking lot, 20 spaces on the right, 20 spaces on the left, bordered by two roads, Montauban Street, Bennett Street. So typically what I would do is go in, go through the right-hand side, no place, no spots, go out into Bennett Street, come back into the left side, and then go around and around until finally you see somebody walk towards a car with keys in their hand, and oh, they're going on the left side, out to Bennett Street. There's another car that grabs that spot right in front of you. So that Saturday morning, I don't know why, I said to myself, you know what, I'm going to forget about the spots on the left. I'm just going to turn off the engine, stay on the right. And as soon as I turned off my engine, strange physicist that I am, I thought, how long am I going to have to wait before somebody frees up a car? And I thought about it for a spot. And I thought about it for a moment, and after about 20 seconds, I'd estimated it would take 3 minutes. So I looked at my watch. You know what? 3 minutes later, somebody came and freed up a spot. You know, I felt so good. Now, imagine we turned that into an exam problem. On a Saturday afternoon, you pull into a parking lot with unmetered spaces near a shopping area. You circle around, but there are no empty spots. You decide to wait at one end of the lot where you can see and command about 20 spaces. How long do you have to wait before someone frees up a space? I guarantee you, if you put this on one of your exams, the students are going to go to the dean or the rector and try to get you fired. What are the skills you need to answer this question? Well, you need to make assumptions. You need to develop a model. And then you need to apply that model. In terms of Bloom's taxonomy, we're all the way at the top. Creativity. Let's look at that list, since the students are going to get us fired. Let's carefully examine that list on the left. Which is the skill that students hate the most? And students, you're free to pitch in too here. I hear it right away here from the students. Beautiful, beautiful. Making assumptions. I mean, it's frightening, right? There's an uncertainty associated with assumptions. What if you make the wrong assumption? It never occurs to people that you can always revisit your assumption, right? You can make an assumption, solve a problem, and then say, what if my assumption was not right and it's higher or lower? So you can always revisit your assumptions, but that's a frightening prospect. However, let's face it, the ability to make assumption is really what distinguishes individuals. A successful businessman from a less successful businessman. A successful scientist from a less successful scientist. Making assumptions is actually critical. Why do we rob our students of the opportunity to train those assumption skills, right? If you get an interview at McKinsey or Google, the first thing they're going to ask is, they're going to ask you a question where you have to think on your feet and make assumptions. Our students are ill-prepared to do that. And later in their professional lives, they're going to have to make assumptions all the time. I know if I give an exam, I don't anymore, but if I gave an exam, and there's a problem that doesn't specify everything, a hand will go up and say, Professor, are we supposed to assume here that we can ignore friction? Even if it's completely clear from the context, they want you as an instructor to take the responsibility for the assumption. Okay, so since they had assumption, let's put the assumption in. On average, people shop for 2 hours. 2 minutes is obviously too short, 2 days is too long, so yeah, it's a reasonable assumption. In terms of Bloom's taxonomy, we're still sort of very near the top, right? Because you need to develop a model and then apply that model. Still, you know, the students are running to the administration to say, you know, Professor Mazur has gone totally crazy. Get him out of this university. So let's put the model in the problem implicitly. We add one more sentence. We say, assuming people leave at regularly spaced intervals. Now, you know, we've given everything that there is to know in the problem. In terms of Bloom's taxonomy, we've actually dropped all the way down to the applying level. And still, students would be horrified. Professor, we've never done any parking lot problems before. Actually, you know, I tell my students, look, if you had done this problem before, it would, by definition, no longer be a problem. Okay, so let's now turn it into a standard textbook problem, the one that you find in the back of textbooks and that, you know, many faculty members assign to the exam. Here we go. On a Saturday afternoon, you pull into a parking lot with unmetered spaces near a shopping area where people are known to shop, on average, for 2 hours. You circle around, but there are no empty spots. You decide to wait at one end of the lot where you can see and command about 20 spaces. How long do you have to wait before someone frees up a spot? And you go, well, wait a minute, isn't that the problem we started with? Yes, but somewhere in the book or in the course, the students have encountered this equation, which is colloquially known as the parking lot equation. The time you have to wait is the time that people shop on average divided by the number of spaces. And all they need to do is plug the numbers into the equation. And now, in terms of Bloom's taxonomy, we've dropped all the way to the bottom. All the way at the bottom. We've taken a problem that was at the top and turned it into a problem at the bottom. Maybe I've exaggerated a little bit, but I can tell you, I've looked at some of my old exams that I used to give, and I've looked at exams from colleagues, and there are more problems in the latter category than in the first on most of the assessment that we use. And I think this is particularly important in the 21st century. Because I predict that just as, well, no, first of all, I think it's important because computers can do that, right? I'm carrying on my belt a device that can plug numbers into equations and solve them. And I predict that just as robots have replaced assembly line jobs, so will computers replace any job that requires the recall of information. I got my phone here to recall information for me, or the application of rote procedures. And therefore, we really should focus on authentic problem solving. But there's something truly scary about authentic problem solving. The road to creative problem solving or to authentic problem solving is erratic. It's not that you just do it and get the answer, no. You try one approach, might fail. You try a second approach, might fail again. If you're lucky, the third approach will work. The road to innovation, the road to creativity, is littered with failures. Thomas Edison, who invented the light bulb, this is fluorescent lights, but imagine these were light bulbs, right? He didn't just invent a light bulb. He had something like 300 failed prototypes. Most people would have thought, you know, you're totally crazy. But he persisted in light of repeated failures. Our students are failure averse. Failures is seen as a bad thing, not as a byproduct of looking for something creative. You make a mistake, you lose points, you get punished. And therefore, the assessment, in a sense, kills creativity and innovation in the bud because it discourages our students from taking risk, from sticking out their neck, from doing something new, something creative. I'm going to jump here. This picture
needs no words. You saw right away what this represents. And if this paper evokes some pleasant memories, then I'd like to talk to you when we're having drinks outside there. What are some of the feelings that come to mind when you see this picture? Just blurt it out.
Stress.
Anxiety. Boring.
Panic.
What?
Panic.
Panic. Oh, these are words that are so conducive to learning, are they not? What else? There's something truly surprising about that picture. Look at it carefully. Not this picture in particular. It could be any picture of an exam. They're all similar. What is it? Uniform, but what else? Solitude, isolation. Look at these people. They don't have any smartphone, calculator, computer, whatever on there. They're cut off from any source of information, no books, nothing. And they're cut off from any other human being. You know, I heard that now for the SATs in the US, you're not even allowed to bring a watch. It could be a smartwatch. Soon the students will have to start take the exams naked because, you know. Now ask yourselves, since you took your last exam, this, by the way, students, this is addressed not to you, but to the instructors here. Since you took your last exam, however long time ago this might be, have you encountered any situation in your professional life where you've similarly been cut off from any other human being or any source of information? No. When I am in my office writing a paper about nanophotonics, which is my work, there's not somebody standing next to me saying, you're not allowed to look up the paper by this professor at Yale. You should have known this by heart. I can look up whatever I want, whenever I want it. I can consult anybody I like. Then why? Oh, why do we assess our students in a situation, in a setting, which they are never, ever going to encounter in their professional lives? How can we even imagine that what we measure under those circumstances has any relation to the performance of our students in the real world? Now, traditionally, examinations have been a high-stakes affair. That's why we heard these words, panic, anxiety, stress, culminating in the final exam. Students are told to study for the final exam. But as I already argued, studying for something that comes soon promotes cramming, and cramming only gets the information in short-term memory, and then it's gone after a few days. So there's no retention, no transfer later on to another context. Something interesting happened to me. I gave this talk about a year and a half ago on my own campus. And a month later, I was in Hong Kong giving a talk at the Hong Kong Polytechnic. At the end of the day, 7 p.m., I came back to my hotel room. It was 7 a.m. in Boston, 7 p.m. in Hong Kong, early morning, late evening, or early evening. So I came to my hotel room and I felt my phone buzz. So I looked at my phone, emergency alert system from the campus. If you're in a building, stay in the building. If you're not on campus, do not come. I thought, I was not on campus, obviously, but you know, I thought, what is it? It was the first day of the examinations. And there was a student who didn't want to take the examination, who had called in four bombs in four different buildings. That was not obvious then, of course. So I turned on the TV and CNN, and wow, there was my own camp science center, the building right next to my own building. Yellow tape, police cars, fire trucks. An hour later, I got another emergency alert message. All clear. False alarm, you know, if you can come to, okay.
Now, it's still 1 hour to go. The exams were going to start at 9 o'clock. This was 8 a.m. in Cambridge, 8 p.m. In Hong Kong. 15 minutes later, I get an email from the dean saying, you're undoubtedly aware of the events that have happened on campus. Fortunately, the four buildings where there was a bomb threat have all been declared safe. But in light of the late hour, I've reluctantly decided to postpone the exams that were going to be held in those four buildings for 3 days. And I realize that this postponement is causing problems for the students because they have studied for the exams. Hello. But that's, again, that 3 days, right? I mean, shouldn't you study for life, not just to pass the exam? Now, you know, I don't blame the students. You know, I really think our assessment practices are to blame for that. There are other things. Assessment has two sides. One is the grade, which is a measure of your relative standing compared to others in your class. The other part is feedback, which provides a reflection on what has been learned. This is good, this could be improved, and so on. Research has shown that if there's a grade, if there's a mark, and cipher, on the exam, students ignore the feedback. They focus on this grade. Oh, I got a 6, just enough to pass, good. Or, you know, oh, I got a 9, I want to get high grades. On the other hand, if you take the grade away and you just focus on the feedback, this is good, you might want to rethink this, and so on, students actually focus on the feedback and do significantly better in improving their learning. Then there's something else. Assessment produces a conflict. I became acutely aware of that conflict when I started to teach a project-based class. Last 3 years, I've decided to eliminate exams and eliminate lectures and focus on learning by doing and learning by interacting. And students work on projects where they build things or prepare things. And then at the end of each month, we have a fair where they show what they've done and defend orally, you know, the science that is behind what they've built or prepared. And the first year that I did that, you know, during most of the months, I would be their coach, trying to coach them to be the best they could be. And then at the fair, all of a sudden, I made a Jekyll and Hyde transition from good guy to bad guy, became the judge. What do you mean by that? And I decided it was very uncomfortable because I knew how hard these students had worked, having been their coach. I wanted to give them all an A. Ask yourself about it. As teachers, are we coaches or are we judges? How can we get away with being both? I'm really starting to think that education is just one big cartel. And these robes that we wear at graduation ceremonies, I think, only reinforce that feeling. No, I mean, can you think of any other human endeavor where we combine the role of judge and coach? I can't. It would be unacceptable. Imagine you're coaching a figure skater, and now you go to the Olympics, and you say, good luck, do your best, I'm going to judge you. Nobody would accept that. How do we get away with that in education? How can we do that? I'll tell you how we do that. We do that by hiding behind a thin veil of objectivity. We're going to judge you in a completely fair and objective way that is reproducible so that there's no feelings. 4.2 meters per second for that problem about the car hitting the tree. If you write 4.2 without meters per second, wrong. If you write minus 4.2 meters per second, wrong. If you write 4.2 meters per second, right. If you write 8.3 meters per second, wrong. No feelings involved, very easy. But think about it for a moment. Let's look again at Bloom's taxonomy. Which of those thinking skills can you truly assess objectively, fairly, and reproducibly? All the way at the bottom. In a sense, and I think in the humanities we're doing better, but in the sciences, you know, we force ourselves all the way to the bottom of Bloom's taxonomy. And there's more. I could go on forever, but I want to get to the solutions. You know, there's grade inflation. Grades inch up and up and up and up and up and up. And then there's cheating. Massive cheating all around the world. At Harvard, students cheating on their homework. There was a massive cheating going on recently. Cheating on exams, you name it. Why would a learner be cheating? Have you ever seen a four-year-old cheat while learning how to tie his or her shoelaces? Or a toddler, you know, learning how to put a fork in her mouth, cheat? No. You know, an intrinsically motivated learner will never cheat, because in the end, you're cheating yourself, not nobody else. Cheating is not a problem with the students. Cheating is a problem with the assessment. If there's a shortcut, you know, how can we force, how can we blame students for taking that shortcut? We'd all do that. Okay, so let's turn to the positive. The first thing that I'm going to suggest four things. The first one is, let's mimic real life. Let's not cut off students from the information. Later, they're going to have access to the information anyway. Besides, who are we to determine what information they need later on? The jobs that most of our graduates are going to have, they don't even exist today. It's not the factual knowledge that we stuff into their heads that matters. It's the skills, really. I'm active in nanophotonics now. There was no nanophotonics when I was a student at Leiden. There was no nanophotonics when I was a graduate student at Leiden. There was no nanophotonics when I was a postdoc in the United States. There was no nanophotonics when I was an assistant professor at Harvard or even associate professor, something relatively new. I had to teach myself the vocabulary and everything. Information should stick, not because somebody tells you as a student, trust me, you need to know this. No, it should stick because it's used over and over again. Imagine I'm a physicist and I don't know the mass of the electron. Frankly, I've actually forgotten what the mass of the electron is because I haven't used it in a while, and I don't care. There might be some physicists in the audience who are totally horrified. Well, I don't care. Because if I want to know what the mass of the electron is, this is what I do. Hey, Siri, what's the mass of the electron? And you know, a few seconds later, she, let me have a look, she says. And then a few seconds later, here she gives it. Wow, look at that. She gives it in kilo electron volts per C squared. She gives it in grams, in kilograms, with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 digits. There's no way I could ever remember that. Now imagine there's a week where I do that 5 times, 6 times, 7 times, 10 times in a row. The 11th time, I don't even have to do it anymore because I remember it. It sticks. It sticks not because somebody tells me, Eric, if you don't know the mass of the electron, you can't be a physicist. No, it sticks because I need it and I use it. I think it was Einstein who once said, and I think it's actually a sad statement, education is what is left after all that is learned is forgotten. It's not the facts. It's not the facts. The facts will come, and we don't know what facts our students need to have in their head. So I knew this early on in my teaching career. You know, the first year that I taught, I thought, you know, why do I want these pre-medical students to memorize Kirchhoff's laws and all these other things? You know what? I'm going to give them one sheet with the relevant equations at the exam. The next year, some students had seen my sheet of equations, and they said, couldn't I bring my own sheet
of formulas. And I said, sure, one index card, 7 inches by 5 inches, one side only. Only to discover that students develop microscopic handwriting where they put the entire book on one side of the paper. So the next year I said, you know what, just bring the book to the exam. The following year, one student came to me and said, in high school, I used this other book for physics, which I like more than the book that you assigned. Could I bring this other book? I thought, if I do that for that student, I have to do it for all the students in my class. So, and since they don't all use the same book in high school, it means I can have them bring any book. And I thought about it. I said, you know what? Fine. I don't care. So I said, you can bring any book you want. Some students come. It's a whole thing. The next year, some students said, could I bring my notes and solutions to the problem sets? I thought about it. I said, you know what? You can bring anything you want except another living person. And some students brought a lot. But then more recently, I started to assess my students on their laptops, which means that they have access to Google. Is that a problem? Should I shut off the internet in my classroom? I thought about it for a while, and I said, no. Because let's think again about Bloom's taxonomy. What does access to Google do? It eliminates that bottom level. I would argue any question to which the answer can be found on Google is not an authentic assessment question. Yes, this forces me to take my exams and see if I can Google my questions, so I have a little bit more work before the exam, but at least it forces me up Bloom's taxonomy. My assessment automatically becomes more authentic. I'm going to jump. I'm going to show you a little video clip. This video clip was recorded in Bandung, Indonesia, at the Bandung Institute of Technology. And I don't know what the music was. It was not part of my presentation. It's a class that is taught at that institute. And I want you to look at this video. I chose that one because it's the students speak Bahasa Indonesia. So you can't, unless there might be one or two people, but most of you probably won't, understand what they're saying. And I want you to determine two things. One is, what is the discipline of this course? The second part is, what in the world are the students doing there? How does it fit into the curriculum? That is my computer. Sorry. Can I have the volume up a little bit? So the first question was kind of unfair, right? I mean, how can you tell what the discipline is? But some, maybe somebody wants to venture a guess. Nanophotonics. Bandung Institute of Technology. I mean, No. This is a class of statistics. Have you ever seen students having fun with statistics? Now you have. What are those students doing there? What is it? What is it? What are they doing? Talking, calculating, but you know, where would it fit into the curriculum? Probably giving a test. These students are taking a test. Isn't that a cognitive dissonance? I mean, they're talking to each other, they're having fun, and they're taking a test. The first time that I came across this was at the University of Delaware. This is actually an assessment technique from team-based learning. If you want more information on it, go to teambasedlearning.org, one word. First time that I encountered this was at the University of Delaware. I was Phi Beta Kappa Visiting Scholar, which is a distinction that brings you to different campuses for 2 or 3 days. You attend different classes, you give talks in different departments, you visit, you know, student organizations, you talk to the administration of the university. At the University of Delaware, on my schedule was a visit to a biochemistry class. So at the appointed hour, I go to the right building, I look up the classroom, I go to the classroom, door is open, there are no students inside, 5 round tables, each with 8 chairs, and a bearded professor who is putting down pieces of paper on the table. So I go over to him, and I introduce myself. He says, oh, thank you for visiting today. This is great. We're having an exam. I thought, why would they have me visit a classroom during exam? I thought, this is great. I'm going to go outside and do my email, and we can talk later. So I said, should I go outside? And, you know, I'll wait till you start it, and then we can talk. No. I want you to take the exam. What's the exam about? Hemoglobin. I said, I don't know anything about hemoglobin. But before I could protest, I found myself at a table with 7 other students. I was not in a good mood. You know, I mean, I didn't know anything about hemoglobin, and I really wanted to check my email, but I couldn't. Anyway, so at some point, we were allowed to turn the exam over. Multiple choice questions. My mood went from bad to worse, you know. I looked at these questions. None of them made any sense to me. And they were all multiple choice, as I said. I noticed that the students had a little strip of paper on which they wrote the answer. I couldn't see because they were too far from me, but, you know, 1C, 2B, and so on. After 20 minutes, the instructor picked up these little pieces of paper. I'd left mine blank because I really didn't know. That's 50% of the credit. Then he put on each table one of these cards called an if-at-scratch card, instant feedback assessment technique. On the vertical, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, the number of the question. On the horizontal, A, B, C, D. At the intersection, the paint that you have on a lottery card, you know, that scratch card. And the card has been pre-printed so that the correct answer has a star underneath that scratch paint. But there's only one card per table. So the first thing that the students at my table did was, who wants to be the scratcher? Do you want to be the scratcher? Okay, Elmer is going to be the scratcher. So then that student went around the table and said, one was a really easy question. I had C. What did you have? C, C, C. Everybody agreed on C. So the scratcher said, shall I scratch off C? Yep. Okay, scratch off C. Star. Yes, we got it right. I thought, okay. So now we're making a game out of this. You know, what's the point? But then they came to question number 2. Half of the table has said A, the other half said B. The A's didn't want the B to be scratched off. They wanted A to be scratched off. The B's didn't want A to be scratched off, but B. All of a sudden, they started to argue. Don't you remember in class, the professor said that when hemoglobin, I don't know what, you know. They started to argue like biochemists. It was no longer about the answer. It was about the reasoning that led to the answer. At some point, some consensus emerged. I think it's B, because that's right when, okay. So everybody agreed, some reluctantly, but others did not. They scratched B. No star. Here's the genius of the method. If you get it right the first time, you get 4 points. So for question 1, they got 4 points. If you don't get it right the first time, you can try a second time for 2 points. If you get it wrong a second time, you can try a third time for 1 point. If you still get it wrong, you don't get any points, but you know what the answer is. So the students were teaching each other, and there were actually aha moments. There were students who went, oh, yes, now I get it. You could see it right in front of them, learning happening during an assessment. They were having fun, scratching, and yes, we got it right. And you know what? At the end, they could just add up the numbers. You can add up 4, 2, 1. You also know what you answered as an individual. 50% of the credit is the team grade. 50% of the credit is the individual grade.
You have an interest in doing as well as possible on the individual part, and you have an interest in doing as well as possible on the team part. So by the time the students walked out, they were relaxed, they were, you know, they knew their grade, they'd received feedback, they'd learned. And you know what the best part is? There's no grading. It's done. One requirement, you have to make this hard enough so that no single individual aces the individual round. In fact, the average on the individual round should be low, like 30 or 40%, so that even the best student isn't 100% sure of his or her answers, and there's no, you know, team where the person says, oh, this student is the best student when he or she says A, it's A, and so on, and people just take answers on authority. So you have to make it significantly harder than you would make a normal individual test. I came back from that trip thinking, this is great, but I dislike multiple choice questions. It's hard to design good and effective multiple choice questions. But then we developed learning catalytics, and that provided an avenue to testing using open-ended questions. Just to show you an example, this would not be a good assessment question. You can ask questions like, what is the derivative of that function, 3x squared minus 6x? And the students actually can enter mathematical notation, and the program is able to interpret mathematical notation. But it could also be a drawing, or a sketch, or a vector, or a number with units, or text, or a sketch where you point at something. There are many different modalities, and they're open-ended. They're not multiple choice. So the students answer in the individual round however many questions there are. In this case, there were a couple only, but this was a mock test. But in the ones I use in my classroom, there are typically 10. So they get 40 minutes to answer the 10 questions individually. And then I press on a button, and the students see the same 10 questions, but now at the top of the screen, they can see what the other students have answered. Brent, why do you have 6x and not 6x minus 6? Right? And they basically start to talk to each other, and they go to the board and help each other. So if you walk into my classroom, if you could have the sound up a little bit, during the individual round, you don't hear anything because it's silent. They have their computers in front of them. They can Google whatever they want. They're not allowed to email each other or to text each other. That's the only restriction. And then during the team round, you see something that looks very different from a normal exam. They talk to each other. This clearly had to do with the right-hand rule, as you can see. They go to the board. I make a habit of bringing visitors in during the team round, not the individual round. I just bring them in. I don't tell them what is going to go on. And then I ask them to walk around and, you know, even talk to the students. And then afterwards, I think, what do you think the students are doing? Group work, you know, problem solving. Mm-mm. They're taking an exam. What? You know, can't be. Okay, so that's number one. The second one is, let's focus on feedback, not on ranking. I frankly think that objective ranking is a complete myth. I can make a long list of people who flunked out of college or dropped out of college. There's one of them. Bill Gates is another one at my institution. But there's really a very long list. You can probably name some of your own people who you studied with or went to high school with and who became immensely successful. Likely, you can make probably an even longer list of people who had stellar grades, and then you look back 10, 20 years later, where have they gone? Let me show you some data from my own classroom. Two different metrics, two results. This was when I was still teaching a fairly traditional class and using fairly traditional exams, long time ago. On the left, the final grade on a scale of 0 to 100. On the horizontal, the result of an assessment that using words only tests students' understanding of the concept of force. And you see there is some correlation, but the correlation is certainly not very high. According to the person who wrote this test, anybody who scores below 23 is still an Aristotelian thinker, connecting force to velocity rather than the Newtonian model, force and acceleration. And as you can see, in my class at Harvard, some 70% of the students are still Aristotelian thinkers at the end. Yes, they're able to solve a complicated problem involving calculating the moment of inertia of a three-dimensional object by carrying out a three-dimensional integral, but they have no clue really what Newton meant with his laws. By the way, if you take a gorilla and you ask the gorilla to take that test, the one that's on the conceptual understanding test, the gorilla will just press random buttons, right? Well, they'll score around 10. So you see, some students at Harvard actually belong in the primate section of the zoo. If you ask a physics professor or a postdoc or a graduate student to take this conceptual understanding, they end in these last three bins. When I took the test, I got 28 out of 29. There are 29 questions. I think I misread a question or something. No, I actually made an honest mistake. We all make mistakes, right? So you see, some of my students actually score at that level. But again, there's a very broad range of grades, right, from 60% to 100%. Look at these two students. The one on the left got an A, but did not understand the concept of force discussed in week two. If you don't understand force, you don't understand momentum, you don't understand work, you don't understand energy, you really don't understand anything. You might be able to manipulate the equations and get the right answer, but you don't understand a thing, and you're likely to forget very quickly. The one on the right scored at the level of a postdoc or faculty member and got a C. Is that objectivity? Or is that an injustice? The next thing is, not only should we focus on feedback rather than grades, we should focus on skills, not content. The traditional approach to teaching is to make a list of content. In this course, we're going to cover topic A, topic B, topic C, topic D. And then we start teaching, and then the assessment is an afterthought. Let's see if they understand topic A, topic B, topic C, and let's find an objective way of assessing that. In that case, the course is completely determined by the content. A much better approach, which is advocated in this book, Understanding by Design, by Grant Wiggins and Jay McTighe, is not to start at the input end, but to start at the output end and work backward from the output, the same way you would solve an authentic problem. What do I want my students to be able to do after taking this course? This actually makes a lot of sense to most of my colleagues, but it's actually not easy to come up with good learning outcomes. A lot of my colleagues think about it for a while and then they say, let's see. After taking this course, you will be able to understand topic A, topic B, topic C, topic D. But then essentially you're back to where you started. And, you know, in order to formulate a good learning outcome, you have to ask yourself, what am I going to accept as evidence that we've actually accomplished those learning outcomes? And if you can't formulate any acceptable evidence, then your learning goal is not really useful, and you should go back and try to reformulate your that particular learning outcome. And then the last thing you do is, what is the instructional approach I'm going to use in order to maximize the input? In this case, the course is completely determined by the output, by the outcomes, not by the input. But you know what's even better? You've actually thought about the assessment while designing your course. You already have ideas about how to assess your students in a more meaningful way. So let's focus on skills, not content. The last thing is, let's resolve this coach-judge conflict, which, you know, forces us to probe at a really low level on Bloom's taxonomy. You know what I did in my course? And yeah, it was really simple. I asked my colleagues to come and assess my students. Let them be the bad guys. I can remain the coach. Yes, of course, I give the external evaluators the rubric that I designed, but they're the ones who evaluate the students in terms of the rubric. It has a couple of benefits, actually. First of all, if they're engineering students, I can also ask some students, some professors from the engineering department to come and judge. The students might know these professors from the engineering courses, so it sort of links the evaluation in one course to things that are taught in the other. And it validates what happens in my course in the eyes of my colleagues. They can't come to me and say, oh, Eric, your students, they're just having fun. They're not learning anything. Well, just go and ask them any question you like, and they can see what my students learn. And then I think we should really involve the students more in peer and self-evaluation. Think about it. What is it that permits an individual to continue to progress after graduating from an institution? When we, you and I, give our students their diplomas, that's not when learning stops. That's actually when learning really starts. And you are on your own. You need to determine yourself whether you've learned something, how you need to improve, where you can progress. So being able to assess your own learning, what educators call metacognition, is really important. We provide our students very little opportunity to assess themselves. You take an exam, you hand it in. 2 weeks later, when you've forgotten about the whole thing, you get the thing back with a number on it. You have no idea how your work compares to that of other students in the class. So bringing in self and peer assessment, providing students an opportunity to reflect on their own work, to place their work in the context of others. Student may see his or her work and see anonymously, of course, work from other students and think, oh, I'm much better than them. Or might think, wow, I wish I'd written that or done that type of work. You can judge yourself relative to others without it being a humiliating experience the way it is with grades. And that's the way we progress later in life. Now you think, isn't that a lot of work? Yes, but there are some nice tools like this calibrated peer review, which was developed at UCLA. Very unfortunate acronym, CPR. Will yield a lot of websites that have nothing to do with calibrated peer review, cardiopulmonary resuscitation. But it fully automates the self and peer review process. As an instructor, you have to do a little bit more work beforehand, but there's no grading afterwards, because in essence, you put your grading into a well-designed rubric and into three exemplar pieces that you upload together with the grading. I don't have time to really go into any details, but I urge you to have a look at it. My time is up, and I want to leave a little bit of time for discussion, so I want to end here with a call to action. And the call to action is really simple. We must rethink assessment. Because if we don't, then we will continue to educate the followers of yesterday rather than the leaders of tomorrow. And perhaps even more importantly, unless we rethink assessment, our assessment is never going to tell us who is going to be successful later in their careers and who is not going to be successful. Thank you very much for your attention. So we have some time left for discussion. So
please wait till you have the microphone.
And you want two people to state what department and...
Okay. Okay, I'm at Faculty of Mathematics and Natural Sciences, and I'm sometimes a teacher and sometimes do other things. But so my question actually is, you were talking about assessment as a way of learning, and that we should think of different ways of assessments to really assess learning and not to assess memorizing. But I'm wondering, we always give grades to classify the students. Would you also suggest to remove grading, to stop with grading?
The short answer is yes. I would love to eliminate grades. By the way, I want to rephrase the first part of your question a little bit. I would say I would like to see a success for learning rather than off learning, right? In order to promote learning rather than grading. Yes, I would love to eliminate grades. Think about it for a moment. Think about one of your own students in your own courses, right? How can you possibly capture an individual, the performance of an individual, with a number or a letter? In my own class, I keep track of a lot of different learning outcomes: self-directed learning, content mastery, teamwork, professionalism. At the end of the course, I end up with numbers for each of those. 0 means deficient. 1 means needs improvement. 2 meets expectations. In rare instances, I give a 3, which means exceptional, but there's only 1 or 2% who gets that. So at the end of the semester, I have a string of numbers, 2, 1, 2, 2, let's say. So I can tell, oh, this student met expectations in terms of self-directed learning. The content, you know, could use improvement. The teamwork, great job. Professionalism, immaculate. So if you were to come to me and say, how did that student do? I could tell you that story. Another way would be to say, oh, this student, 7. What does that tell you? Nothing, right? It really tells nothing. And also, probably that 7 only means we've been measuring that student's performance along only one dimension. I'm on the admissions committee for the graduate school in the School of Engineering. Read a lot of folders from students from all over the world. China, US, institutions I've never heard of, institutions I've heard of, Europe. I see these transcripts come in that are just amazing. I mean, we get a sort of self-selected group of students applying to Harvard, so they tend to be all pretty good, you know, straight A's, not one A minus, a grade point average that's the highest you can possibly imagine. You look at the essay, it's pretty good. And then you admit the students, and a year later they come onto campus, and you think, oh, how did we admit this student? You know, he doesn't even know how to tie shoelaces, so to speak, right? They're missing a crucial skill that is actually much more relevant to the performance in doing independent research than, you know, being able to solve exams as reflected by grades. What we do now is we actually interview students. We found that we pre-select them. Unfortunately, you know, we get so many students, we need to have some way of pre-selecting them. But I honestly do not think that grades are an adequate reflection. Yes, they're easy and convenient, and maybe they're reproducible, but they really don't tell us what we want to know. I was very happy. This was yesterday. Was it yesterday? I mean, the last few days are a blur. I was at the university in Twente and University College Twente. No grades. I was at, by the way, after I gave this talk at Harvard, I went out to dinner with the dean of the college, and he was all fired up. He said to me, Eric, we have to eliminate grades. Well, it's a year and a half later now, nothing has happened. So I don't, maybe I have to give this talk again a second time. Another question, yes.
Please stand up for the live stream.
It is a little difficult. My name is Saka Jager. I work in the Faculty of Arts. I'm an ICT and a learning supporter. My question actually has to do with the type of exam halls that you showed. Our university is investing heavily in those, millions. But of course, this is a kind of legacy thing because we need them to service the teachers what they want. I was also involved in the development of the online, the digital testing that goes on in this space. What would you advise us? Where would we perhaps better spend the money than investing in these large exam halls?
That's a very good question. And you know, you mentioned something there in passing that I think is a big obstacle, right? Why are we, this did not come across in our initial discussion here, but why are we giving exams? Because we've always given exams. Interestingly, I recently looked at the history of examinations at universities. A while back there were no examinations. There was assessment, but there were no examinations and grades. It started in the 18th century, almost 300 years ago, at the University of Cambridge in the mathematics department, where they would have what they call tripos. I don't know what that stands for exactly, but it was a tournament. They would take the mathematics students and in a three-day event have them compete against each other with increasingly difficult mathematics problems. And then at the, it was like a tournament in sports, right? But now this was a tournament in solving mathematics problem. And in the end, you, after three grueling days, you would end up with the winner. And you had a pecking order of these students and their ability to solve difficult examination mathematics problems. And that then later evolved into, you know, a more customary examinations and was adopted by other disciplines. But until then, and until actually probably the middle of the 19th century, we did not have this custom of giving grades and giving examinations. So I think the first thing to do is to actually have a discussion like we're having now, and you probably need to continue that discussion. I hope that you'll be more successful here than I was at my own institution. And that if I come back a year and a half from now, well, you may have started to reconsider, you know, what the goal is of education, and I trust that if you take some of the four recommendations that I have there, and start implementing them, you'll be moving into a productive direction that's going to focus more on the learning than on the memorization.
Hello, my name is Mark van der Marel. I teach at the Faculty of Mathematics and Natural Sciences only for a few years now. And what I wonder is, how do you feel about oral exams?
What kind of exams?
Oral exams. Verbal exams.
Oh, yeah. Well, an oral exam is an oral assessment. Let's get rid of that word exam. But an oral assessment, of course, is in a sense in agreement with a lot of what I told you. I mean, when you have an oral exam, it's, in a sense, it's like an interview, right? If our ability to assess our students was flawless, let's imagine that all the grades that we give a student on their transcript are immaculate and actually give a perfect picture, then companies would not even bother looking at any transcripts. They would just say, oh, I'm gonna hire him and hire her and her there, based on simply those numbers that we provide. But as you and I know, there's not a single company in the world that would even think of that, right? How do they hire people? By interviewing them, which in a sense is an oral exam, because you get such a better feeling for how people can think on their field, you know, what their experiences are and so on. It's not flawless either, otherwise we would never make hiring mistakes, but I think it's significantly better than a written examination. And in a sense, what I do with my projects and my project-based course by having external evaluators is an oral assessment. They talk to the students and probe their knowledge.
Do we have a question from our colleagues in Amsterdam?
Yes. There were a few questions. Let me see. Um, Yeah, there were a few questions about the assumptions, how you actually teach students to make the assumptions.
Ah, very good. Thank you for asking that. Yes, how do you teach students to make assumptions? Well, I actually build in to my course heavily a number of activities that force my students to come up with estimates. I start, when they don't have much physics knowledge, I start very simple. How many hair on a human head? So you have to estimate what the spacing is of hairs, and then you know what the area is that's covered by hair, and you know, you divide the two, and you come up with an answer. And then as we learn physics, I try to put the estimation in the context of the physics that they learn. In electrostatics might be, you know, what is the potential difference between a thundercloud and ground just before lightning hits? And what I do is I give my teams a sheet that has five estimation problems, and I give them half an hour as a team to come up with the five orders of magnitude. In other words, they don't have to tell me 3.456 volts per meter. No, I want them to give just the order of magnitude, 10 or 100 or 1,000 or a million or 10 to the 23 or whatever. And the first team to give the right orders of magnitude, within one order of magnitude, for all five of these questions wins. They don't win anything, but they win. It's amazing what that does to people. They'll go at it with an energy, and you know, since there's nothing to lose, they'll do their best to be the first team to come up with the right estimates. And then on the assessment, I will build in, or actually on, when they do that, when they solve problems, I have a final step, which is always evaluate the answer. Well, how do you evaluate an answer? The only way to evaluate an answer is to estimate what you would get by making simple assumptions. So they get to use that skill then in evaluating their own work. And on the assessment, we put again estimation questions. So it's a continuously reinforcing cycle. That's what we do.
Hello, Mark Pauli from the philosophy department. I was wondering, you mentioned that one of the problems with testing was also that they do not quite predict, say, future success in any way, you know, so that there's very little relation between the grade someone gets and the job he might get later. But I was wondering, is this really something, a correlation that we should even strive for as a university? I mean, when I teach, I never think that my grades in any way have to be related in any sense to future success of some sort. And isn't that actually part of the problem also, that we as university take on that role of assessing people for companies, whereas we should say, well, if Apple wants to know whether someone is good for the job, let Apple test it. Don't ask us to test that.
In fact, they do. In fact, they do, right? They mostly ignore transcripts. I totally agree with you. In fact, I have very little to add to your remark. I don't think we can objectively assess, and our goal is really to produce the most successful graduates. Imagine the number of talent we lose because we discourage them. Well, I mean, there might be people who have fantastic abilities but happen to be not such good test takers. If they don't decide, like Steve Jobs, who had on the screen there, to drop out and do their own thing, which I think is rare, they'll get nowhere in society. We're probably wasting talent that way. And then we're producing people that we recommend very highly to companies by giving them a great transcript, and they turn out to be not so good. So I think the current system is just not very good. I totally agree.
Question from students, perhaps?
I hope I didn't discourage them. Follow your heart. Follow the learning. The rewards will, that's what I tell my own students, you know, the rewards will come with the learning. They don't come with grades. They come with the learning. Develop the skills you think you need.
Hi, I'm Jorik, Faculty of Economics and Business. I was questioning when I saw your course and your students doing the exam, how do you tackle group formation? Because that's often a topic that concerns, especially at the start of courses, at least the students and more also the teachers. Is it randomly or signing in and be the first? How do you tackle that?
No, it's neither of those two. It's not random. And it's not self-selected. Both of those turn out to be really bad teams, on average. What we do is we actually engineer the teams. So we measure, we take a number, we take data. What is the gender? We know that from the registrar's list. We make sure that we have no single gender teams, so no all-female or all-male teams. Also, since science tends to be a male-dominated world, we want no teams with four males and one female. So that's one rule. The second rule is that we spread them out according to year in college. I have students in first year, second year, third year, and fourth year. The first and second year tend to be the engineers. The third and fourth years are the pre-medical students who want to postpone physics as long as they can. Right? So I don't want four or five freshmen in a team. Because you know these would I want some more experienced students, so I take fourth-year students, and so I tell the program that makes the team spread them out. I look at their self-efficacy. We give them a questionnaire that basically measures their self-efficacy. Self-efficacy is your belief in your ability to succeed in a certain field, right? So when you have a high self-efficacy and you do poorly, you tend to say, let's say you have a low self-efficacy in physics, and then you take a test and you do poorly. You tend to say, oh, physics is too hard for me, I can't do it. If you have a high self-efficacy and you do poorly, you explain it to yourself by saying, I had a bad day, or I should work harder next day, right? And we all have different self-efficacies. I have a very low self-efficacy in singing, so I'm not gonna sing for you, don't worry. And if I do a bad job and I'm embarrassed, I'll say, I just can't sing, right? But I have a pretty high self-efficacy in physics. I've learned to sort of trust my abilities in that field. I don't want a team where there are five students who all say, physics is too hard for me. So I measure the self-efficacy, I put some low self-efficacy scores and higher. I look at their attitudes towards learning. There are some students who are faculty-centered and who think, you know, I'm not coming to class to learn it all myself. The professor has to teach it to me. And then there are other students who are really like to roll up their sleeves and be self-directed. So I measure that, I attach a numerical score to it, and I spread them out. Because imagine you have a team of five students, and they all think, I didn't pay this tuition in order to learn it all myself from a book. Professor Mazur should lecture us. That's only going to reinforce each other and create problems for me. So I spread them out in that dimension. So that's just to give you an idea. So I engineer the teams, and each semester students work in three monthly team arrangements. So the first month it might be the five of us together, and then we get spread apart. We'll never work together anymore that semester. There are four new people. So this means if we happen to engineer a poor team, let's say that the five of us, for some reason that I have not measured, happen not to get along very well and not work very effectively, you know, it will only affect a third of the semester, and the other two-thirds, we probably will have a better team. Very important. Thank you for asking that question.
Okay, the final question over here, and then we will go for a drink.
I'm Peter Buller from the Faculty of Philosophy and from Development Studies. I wonder how you look at anonymous testing. Here in the university, many people try to come to a system where you don't know which student you paper you assess. And in my faculty, I was the only one resisting this because I said, I want to know who wrote it. And maybe for some person, it is much greater achievement to come up with this text than for another one. But I was the only one in my faculty, so I hope to get some support from you.
I hope that the students know what they do on the test. That it's not that, you know, you hand in the test and it goes into a black hole. So at least they know how they do, right? It's only you who doesn't know how they do. Is that correct?
No, the name of the student.
The name of the students, but the students themselves see how they do or not even that.
Do the students get feedback on it? Oh, okay, good, because otherwise, why even do it, right? I don't know. I mean, it depends on what you want to do with that grade, but much more importantly, I think what matters is not just the grade or anything, it's the quality of the questions and what they test. So I'm afraid I can't really answer your question without seeing and determining where on Bloom's taxonomy, for example, that test scores. If it's a test that mostly tests regurgitation or the application of rote procedures, then, you know, just don't give the whole test, right? If it's a test that tests creativity all the way at the top, then it might be a good test. You know, why hide the identity of the students for you? I don't know. You don't ask them to come to class with a brown bag over their head so that you can't see who they are, right? Sorry, you have to treat us all anonymously. So I don't know. I don't know. I see no reason. But I think the more important question is this a valid test? Does it test meaningful things?
Thank you very much. Maybe you have another question. We will go afterwards for a drink in the next building, so you can ask Eric. But Eric, thank you. Thank you very much. More than half a year ago. More than half a year ago, we started thinking about Tour de Mazur, and today actually is our harvest of Tour de Mazur. And I think maybe to the force is also a good verb for you. Let me see. And now there is some time to relax.
God. Yeah?
You will stay for some days in Holland, and then you will go back to the USA. But I would like to keep connected in a community. That's one thing. And another thing is that, well, of course, we would like to give you a present, a gift. And maybe you know, but Eric is a really sport fanatic. And skiing, road cycling, mountain biking, mountain climbing, everything is what Eric does. And I hope that we had find a good combination in this gift for you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay,
let's see.
I'm being tested in how to open this gift. Ooh. A GoPro. I don't have one, actually. Thank you. Thank you. I actually don't have one.